directly and say, look, you have to act. And so he calls him, and Patterson won't take the call. And John Kennedy, the president of the United States, is pressing, is saying, you know, where is he? Where is he? And John Patterson in the film is telling the story, and he tells his secretary to say he's in the Gulf fishing. And then he actually says in the film, you know, I lied. I just lied about where I was.
So talk about whether and when he transformed.
I think he's a different man today. And I think, you know, in some ways, he wasn't the man that he appeared to be back then. I think that he felt that to be reelected, and, you know, he was elected on a segregation ticket, that this is what he had to do. But I think that, you know, that the elected officials in the South were really in some ways responsible, you know, if any one person was responsible, you know, for not stopping the violence, for inflaming the violence, for going, you know, he would go with the side of the mob, not against the mob. So when there were riots, he would say, well, it was the Freedom Riders' fault for coming down here, which is, you know, a completely irresponsible thing to do as a governor of a state.
And the role of Dr. Martin Luther King?
The role of King is really strange in the Freedom Rides, because he meets with the Freedom Riders in Atlanta when they first get to Atlanta, and they ask him to go on the ride, and he refuses. And he says, you know, if I were you, I wouldn't go on the rides either, because I have reports that bad things are going to happen in Alabama. So that's the first. He refuses to go. And then after the second wave of Freedom Riders come, and there's a church seize, which Martin Luther King is part of the church seize. He's in the church because he comes down to support the riders. They ask him again, okay, we need you to go on the ride. We need the high visibility that Martin Luther King will bring to this. He still refuses to go. He says, you know, I want to choose the moment of my own death. And he really ticks off a lot of the Freedom Riders, because they felt that having Martin Luther King would give them more publicity, but also, you know, the publicity makes it safer for you. So it's really, it's start of what becomes later on in a split in the civil rights movement between some of the younger people and Martin Luther King.
You're steeped in civil rights history. What did you learn doing this film? What surprised you most, Stanley Nelson?
Well, you know, I think it's a film about what a few people can do, you know, if they just step forward. I mean, that's what's so amazing about the first 12 people who start the Freedom Rides. You know, they have no backing. I mean, you know, everybody's saying, don't do this. You know, the South, you know, you'll get killed. But they do it. They do it, and they end up changing America forever. You know, the signs that say white only, colored only, which had been up for, you know, generations and generations, come down because 12 people say, you know, we're just going to go out there and do it. And I think that's what's important about the Freedom Rides.
Aired at Sundance last week. After break, we go to my interview with the two Freedom Riders themselves. Stay with us.
We're fighting for our freedom.
We shall not be moved here on Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. As we begin Black History Month, we continue with the Freedom Riders. I spoke to two prominent civil rights activists who joined the Freedom Rides. This was in 1961. We sat down at the Sundance Film Festival and talked about this brave moment in history.
I became a Freedom Rider because I was involved in the Nashville movement back in 1960, and I was one of the founders of SNCC, and we wanted to continue the work that we were doing because we've been so successful in desegregating the lunch counters. We say, wow, did we have something now that's going to work, that's going to make a difference? And this whole nonviolence training was the thing that really made the difference. I was going to go on the original Freedom Ride in 1961. In fact, John Lewis and I were going to go. But I needed parental permission because I wasn't going to be 21 until the summer, and they wouldn't let me go. And I tried to get my parents, you know, to sign, and they say, well, you think we didn't read this thing? We're not going to sign your death warrant.
This
you
is Bernard Lafayette.
I say, well, okay, I couldn't go. But once the bus got burned and the Freedom Ride stopped, I didn't have to turn in any papers or get permission. In fact, because that happened, it gave me the freedom to be involved because of what had happened to those other people.
Explain what you mean.
Well, CORE was the sponsor of the Freedom Rides, and they're the ones that required parental permission for anyone under 21. But once CORE stopped the Freedom Rides and had the cooling off period, that's when the students from Nashville took over. So we didn't need parental permission because we, Diane Nash and John Lewis, and those of us who were involved in Nashville, we weren't obligated to any other organization.
What about your parents?
Well, I felt that it was very important for me to do this. Some people were involved in the movement because they wanted to make things better for their grandchildren and their, you know, those who would follow them. No, not me. I wanted to make things better for so my grandparents would be able to enjoy this thing. So I had an urgency and I had a passion that I wanted to see it happen so in their lifetime, because of all they had experienced in the past, that they would be able to enjoy some of this in their lifetime.
Jim Zwerg, talk about how you got involved with the Freedom Rides.
Well, I was also in Nashville. I was an exchange student from Beloit College attending Fisk. And one of the first people I met was John Lewis. Attended some workshops and got to meet people like Bernard and the others. And it was a very simple thing that started it. I asked some of my classmates if they wanted to go to a movie with me, and was informed that we could not go to a movie together because the movie theaters were integrated.
We're so not integrated.
They were not integrated. So ultimately, after a lot of soul searching and prayer, I got involved in Nashville in the stand-ins. And we had, the month before the Freedom Ride started, persevered, and the theaters had opened up without any problems. And I had been selected at that time to be a part of the Central Committee, which was a group of about 24 students or so, representing the various colleges. And when we learned that the CORE group left, our immediate response was, it's got to go on. I was, at that time, the only male, white male, involved in Nashville. And I felt very strongly that the group that went had to be integrated. And so I volunteered, and I was one of those selected to be among the first 10. Students from the movement in Nashville had been through violence. We had been arrested. We'd all had our lives threatened. We were ones that had not broken. And we were the logical ones to continue the ride. Tuesday, May 16th, 1961. We held two meetings today. The first was at 6 this morning, the second from 7 to 1 tonight. After much discussion, we decided to continue the Freedom Ride. Of the 18 who volunteered, 10 were chosen. 3 females and 7 males. We will leave on the Greyhound bus tomorrow morning at either 5:15 or 6:45. We were all again made aware of what